பெரிய புராணம் த ஸ்டோரி ஆஃப் 63 சைவைட் சைன்ட்ஸ் கேண்டோ 1 க்ளோரி ஆஃப் திருமூலை திருமலை சாருக்கம் வர்சஸ் 1-20 மவுண்ட் கைலாஸ் ஷைன்ஸ் லைக் எ கோல்டன் ஃப்ரேம் ஸ்ட்ரீக்டு ஆன் த ப்ரோ வித் த சேக்ரட் ஆஷ் விபூதி எ வெரிட்டபிள் ஒயிட் பிளாசம் ஆன் தி லஸ்ட்ரஸ் கிரீப்பர் ஆஃப் தி வேர்ல்ட் த நான் பரியல் அபோட் ஆஃப் லார்ட் சிவா கார்டட் அட் தி என்ட்ரன்ஸ் பை நந்தி The chief of the hosts halting the swarming hordes of the celestials eager to adore the Lord. It is stated that sage Upamanyu by his austerities had cognized the glory of the Lord, hardly comprehended by the Lord himself or other devotees, and that his loving devotion waxed even more for all time at Kailash. Once a glow brighter than a thousand suns drifted towards Kailash, and the sage immediately divined it as the forum of Saint Sundarar, returning to the Lord after his brief sojourn on earth. And to the inquiring sages, he proceeded to narrate the story of Sundarar. Such is the introduction of Sekijar to his glorious Puranam. Verses 21-29 say, Upamanyu narrates, This glorious one was the attendant of the Lord at Kailash. Having the privilege of offering to the gracious one the sacred ash and garlands for him to wear, he was then known as Alala Sundaran. One day he went to the grove at Kailash to pluck flowers for the Lord. Before him, the lady attendants of Our Lady, the consort of the Lord, with faces more lustrous than the moon and beauty ever growing, had repaired to the same grove to gather flowers to be worn by their lady, whose tresses had natural fragrance. The chief among them were Anindittai of the never-fading beauty and Kamalini of the thick tresses like unto a dark cloud wreathed in fragrant blossoms. In sooth, they were the embodiments of the grace of the Lord of all the celestials. Beholding these two, Sundarar's heart went out to them. And this was reciprocated by the two women. This was the design of the Lord which resulted in the special glorification of the meritorious southern quarter with the boom of the grand composition Tiruthondathohai through the descent on the earth of Sundarar. Cognizing the state of Sundarar, the Lord declared, As you have bestowed your loving glances on the two maidens, all three of you will be born on the earth and taste the joys of love. Sundarar then prayed, O Lord, be graciously pleased to reclaim me before I get debarked by the transient pleasures of earth. The Lord agreeing to this, the three came to be born on earth. Verses 31-36 say, To the inquiring few sages, Upamanyu set out the special glory of the southern quarter. The southern quarter is far more blessed than the celestial regions because it is in southern Bharat that there is the hallowed Chidambaram, where the Lord dances in glee for our mother to behold with love. The great devotee Vyagrapada also adored the Lord there. Furthermore, here in Bhudevi's heart lotus, Arur, where the Ardhra Nareshwara, blossoming in the hearts of all beings and made manifest through the Veda, ever glows. Is not also there the great city Kanchi, adored by the Devas on the bank of the river Kampa, where Our Lady, the mother of the seven worlds, attained the Lord after great austerities? And what about the place of the five rivers, Tiruvayuvar, where the Lord, on whose matted tresses gambols the glorious Ganga and in whose hand glows the flame like a red rose, and Red Rose showed his grace to our master Nandi as the reward for his great austerities. Indeed, the place sanctified by the Lord Tonipura, Brahmapura, Shivali, and the rest in the south are too numerous to declare. All are meet for our adoration. Verses 37-40. Sekijar now adds, Just as the sage Upamanyu narrated of yore to the others at Kailash the gracious deeds of Sundarar, the militant devotee who has given unto us the Tiruton Dattohai, I too will now elaborate them in the presence of the Lord out of my great desire. For my Purana, the source is only the work of Sundarar, who sang it with the grace of the Lord Valmiki Natha. I shall follow also the Tirutondar Tiruvattadai of the Acharya Nambiyandar Nambi, who gave it to us. So to understand aright the original work of Sundarar, I will begin by singing the glory of the cool Choja Nadu, where are to be found the great devotees, whose glory was sung by Nambi Arurar, that is Sundarar. 2. Second chapter. Glory of the blessed land. Tirunathuch Chirappu. Herein is portrayed the fertility and grandeur of the Kaveri region of the Choja. 1-35. Sage Agastyar came to the south from the Himalayas in the north. The water he brought in his water pot Kamandalu began to spread and flow as the river Kaveri near the Kangunadu, where the pot chanced to be overturned. Finding its way through the Cholanadu, it rendered prosperous that region. When its freshness flowed into the fields, the local peasantry, tillers, men and women engaged themselves joyfully in agricultural activities, like transplanting the tender paddy plants, and in due course reaped a rich harvest. The chief produce of the land was rice, along with plentiful sugarcane, plantain and areca. Flower groves, fruit groves, orchids and gardens of tree abounded. The residents thus lived a happy life. They lived a righteous life, strictly following the do's and don'ts of the scriptures. Worship was conducted regularly in all the shrines of the Lord, and the people ever meditated on the Panchakshara. As a consequence, the land was happy, free from all ills. During the benign rule of Anapayachola II, the country was specially prosperous. 3. Grandeur of the city. 1-12. Tiruarur is the most ancient of the many famed cities of the Choja Nadu. Of the several high mansions therein, one was the house of the blessed dam Paravai. Along its highway, the Lord did walk twice as errand messenger from Nambi Arurar to Paravayar. What glory! The house of the contented people were in serried rows. 13-25 verse. In the city of Yore, the ruler was Manuniti Choja. He cared for all living beings as his own eyes and life, and was ever intent on protecting them. He arranged for pujas to be conducted at all shrines in the prescribed way. Under his just rule, the people led righteous lives and prospered materially also. Thus, they were fully happy. He had only one son. In due time, his son grew to be a prince, very learned in all the arts and well-behaved. One day he set out to parade on the royal highway, seated in a chariot and surrounded by his soldiers. A tender calf frisked on the way and got caught under a wheel of the cart and died. Seeing this, the mother cow set up a loud wail, shook in all its limbs and fell down on the ground in great grief. The prince was aghast at this. Ah, what a great ill has chanced. His words faltered. His heart was river with pain. His mind and senses grew numb. What have I done? I have destroyed at once the cow's calf. Feeling thus, he got down from the chariot and fell on the ground. Gazing at the wailing cow and the dead calf, by turns he bemoaned, "Ah, I have been born just to bring infamy on my royal parent, whom all the world hails as its protector. If only the great ones, learned in Vedic lore, could point out a prescribed way by which the great wrong I have done may be wiped out. I will undertake it before my father gets to know the mishap." In this mood, he took himself to the presence of the Vedic practitioners. Verse 26-50. The heart-stricken cow, shedding copious tears, slowly found its way to the gate of the golden palace of the righteous ruler Manu, and with its horns struck at the lovely bell hung there. The grievance bell at the portico of the palace had kept quiet all along. Its sleep was now rudely disturbed. Hearing the din it raised, the king within the palace wondered, is a grievous wrong being proclaimed by beat of drum, or is it the roar of dire sin, or perchance is the clang of the bell around the neck of the mount of Yama coming to snatch the life of my royal son? Rushing down, he met the guards at the gate, who pointed to a cow in the grip of sorrow. In scorn, he asked the ministers around, what injury has been caused to this cow? An old and learned minister said, sir, lord of the plentiful land, your son was riding in a chariot along the royal pathway, surrounded by a large host, when suddenly a little calf gushed in and got crushed beneath a wheel of the chariot. Its mother, this cow, grieving for the mishap, has raised all this din. The ruler now became himself the bereaved cow. He was overwhelmed by sorrow. He broke out, Woe unto me. How chanced this mishap, casting a great slur on my just rule? What amends can I make? The ministers gently answered, sir, your lament is surely not the remedy for this accident. You may make ritual restitution for this unintended wrong as may be prescribed by the priests. The king hit back, fie upon your speech. Will any ritual serve to get back the calf for this cow? Is it not my royal duty to protect everyone from the fivefold harm? If anyone else has been guilty of this crime, would I not have condemned him to death? Talk not to me of this being unprecedented. Your words besmirch the ancient name of Manu, which I bear. And look, should this have happened in this most blessed abode of the Supreme Lord? Well, the only thing for me to do is to take upon myself this cow's sorrow. You, minister, take my offending son and let the chariot wheel run over his heart. The minister, loathed to do the king's bidding, preferred to die himself. Seeing this, the king took his own son and himself rode the chariot over his body. Shall we say that this was a rare deed or any easy one? The watching citizens rained tears while the celestial hosts rained flowers. And lo, the blessed Lord himself appeared in the heavens above, along with his consort mounted on his bull, symbolizing Dharma. At a glance from him, the calf leapt back to life, and so did the prince and the minister too. What is there impossible for the Lord? The cow joyously suckled the calf, and the just king clasped his prince close, and there was cheer everywhere. Would the Lord ever fail his devotees? Hail, hail, the nourishing grace of the Lord. To be continued. Om Namah Shivaya.